This is Jeff Rowley of Flip Skateboards, and I would like to welcome you to the Lemmy Kilmeister Extremely Sorry Soundtrack Interview. The time is 1 p.m., August 17th, 2009, and we're at the Rainbow Room on Sunset Boulevard in Hollywood. This is Lemmy's local drinking haunt, so enjoy. Enjoy the damn interview, you motherfuckers. First off, I'd like to thank you for influencing so many young and old skateboarders out there with your music.
Yeah, it's good skateboarding music, I would think. I don't do much skateboarding myself, you know, I'm a bit past that, but like...
It's never too late.
No, are you sure?
Yeah, sit on the thing, go down the hill.
It's too late for my arms and legs, man.
But I know tons and tons of, like, you know, of my friends I grew up with, young and old, that have been into your music just forever, you know what I mean? And, like, I think that's a testament to, like, the power of the music, you know, the really good writing, the really good, strong, powerful music.
Thank you.
And, you know, I just wanted to say before we even start with the interview.
Appreciate that.
Keep on trucking, you know?
Yeah, really, well, actually, I'm not qualified to do fuck all else anyway.
Well, you know, thankful you're good at what you do, you know?
So. Yeah.
Right, well, I grew up in Liverpool, England, and I remember speaking with you a while back, really briefly, after a Motorhead show where you were pretty much deaf.
Right? Oh, aye.
And I'm pretty much a bad mumbler myself, so it was a fairly
messy conversation. Low tonal register, they call it.
But, anyway, you mentioned to me that you used to go from Wales and travel up to Liverpool to see the Beatles play,
really?
Which is, like, really, I mean, for me, like, coming from the city and hearing you say that is amazing. So I just wondered if you had any, like, visions of the city and of watching the band play that, you know, maybe...
Never so much of the city, really. We just went straight to fucking Matthew Street, you know, and we used to come in at, like, the Central Station, so we weren't that far, you know. Like, yeah. It was a pilgrimage, like, you know. We used to go there quite a bit, not just to see the Beatles, we used to go and see all kinds of bands in the cabin.
The Pacemakers.
Yeah, because you'd have six bands on at the cabin a night, you know. Yeah. And you had the lunchtime thing as well, all the secretaries with their hair and curlers and their head scarves on, you know, eating their lunch, watching the Beatles. Well, yeah, it was your aunts and uncles, wasn't it?
You know, that's why I mention it, because, like, all my aunts and uncles, now if I have conversations with them about, like, the city and about them growing up there,
it's all
they
Beatles.
All went and saw them, they've all got pictures from in there, and they all have stories about, you know, Lennon on stage and
being
aggressive and a bastard, and anyone who says any shit, he knocks them out, whatever it is. And I just wondered if that kind of had any kind of influence on, like, your on-stage presence and your, let me get this correctly, like, your manly swagger or something.
Not the stage presence so much as the attitude, you know. I mean, that's what Motorhead are going to leave behind, not so much the music, I think. A lot of people are just going to remember the attitude, you know what I mean?
I think the light is incredible.
Well, thank you. But, you know. People don't know we got albums out, you know. Because the advertising wing of the record company hasn't been up to much, you know.
But you'll sleep comfortably, you know.
You've
made some incredible stuff the whole of your life. That's, like, how many people can do that?
Yeah, that's because we have total control over what gets released, you know. Except for when it's licensed to another company from our ex-company. You can't help that, but, like...
Well, there's a lot of bastards out there.
Yeah, when we put an album of ours out. Yeah. When we put an album of ours out, then we got total control, you know.
I always felt, you know, deeply connected to the way you write, the way you phrase the lyrics, and the way you deliver, you know, the
music.
Well,
I'm a northern lad, you know.
It always reminded me, like we just said, of, like, my dad and my uncles and my family, really listening to the way it's written. It really did. You know, that same kind of salt of the earth, kind of English.
English
language,
scum,
which is so rare.
Scum suckers,
I mean, well, it's really rare, like, in this day and age. You know?
Yeah, it's all a bit polished now, isn't it? It's all a bit precious.
There's something. I don't know what it is. Maybe it's the generation that you're around now. Maybe I don't feel as connected to them as maybe...
I don't think they do, you know. They're so busy trying to be different. Or trying to be their own person. But there's nothing wrong with that, you know what I mean? But they haven't found anything to go to yet.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? They've, like, got rid of the old stuff, but they haven't found a new one. You know?
Like the internet and all that match, it's just crushed people's individuality and creativity.
A lot of the time it has,
I totally agree. I think it's going to explode. I think that,
implode, yeah.
Yeah.
The fucking internet, man. I mean, you can trust the human race to get to the lowest common denominator of everything.
Yeah.
They get the greatest information organ known to man, and they use it for child pornography, you know. Sure. Great, isn't it?
Yeah, most of the
another winner, you know, for the human race. Yay.